rich churches, rich preachers, and poor saints. Where did we go wrong? There are many sincere men and women of God in leadership roles within the church. There are many who speak the great truths contained in the Word and expound eloquently these truths. But herein does Yahweh have a problem. It is not what is being taught, but what is not being taught. The very cornerstone of his instructions to the church, and that is having all things common. In this hour, Yahweh desires to pour out his Spirit, the latter rain, but he cannot until man presents to him the temple designed after his blueprint, not that of man's designs. This blueprint was given several times in the book of Acts, but has been totally overlooked and trampled on by the contemporary church. The building of the Temple of Solomon, the building of the Ark by Noah, were all types and shadows, examples of the meticulous care that must be adhered to by the servant of God if his work is to be acceptable to Yahweh. If Noah had deviated by one cubit the design of the Ark, it would not have survived the flood. If Solomon, in building the temple, would have deviated from the blueprint given by God, his Spirit would not have come and filled the temple. These are our examples. The church has greatly deviated from the blueprint of Yahweh in establishing the structure of his church, the true ark, the true temple of Solomon, and has presented to Yahweh a structure not of his design. But we seek his approval and acceptance in our Canaanish offerings. We expect that Yahweh will come and fill this temple, his people, with the latter rain of the Holy Spirit, endowing us with the lost power that once pervaded the Christian community, but to no avail. Why? Because Yahweh has not accepted our offering, our church organizations, as they have not been built according to his blueprint. Time is running out for God's people to get this job done and done quickly, as the time of Satan's dominion over his domain is soon approaching. If we are to be able to stand in that day, we must have the latter rain outpouring of the Holy Spirit. In order for the latter rain to come, we must have a church that is built according to his blueprint. Just as surely as the Ark of Noah and the Temple of Solomon. Each of these projects, Noah and Solomon, were given a set amount of time to accomplish their missions. If Noah would have delayed or refused to build according to Yahweh's plan, he too would have been killed in the flood. The church's time is quickly running out, as the flood of evil is even now beginning to overtake America and the world, and still Yahweh has no temple. Since I have not been called to start a church, but to deliver his message to existing churches to get the job done, I adjure you, you church leaders, to consider your churches and how your churches have been set up. Are they built and functioning as those in the book of Acts, where the people had all things common, or have they been built according to the blueprints of man, where the preacher and the church keep the vast majority of the tithes and do not distribute to the poor according to the principles of all things common, that there be none poor among you? Is the preacher being enriched by the tithe of the people, or is everyone being enriched by the tithes and offerings of the people? Is there none poor among you? Time is running out for us to get it right if we desire the power of God to come and fill the temple, us, with his glory. I recently heard a pastor brag to his congregation about contributing $1.5 million to his church's World Missions Fund, then telling the people that if he can give $1.5 million, they should be able to do at least $50 million as a group. Now, what is wrong with this statement according to God's word? First of all, where did the pastor get the $1.5 million in personal funds to give to the church missions fund? From the same people who he just told to give to the missions fund. This is not fleecing the flock, but re-fleecing the flock, an outright robbery of the storehouse by the pastor. Unless that pastor has some other personal business on the side, that money was already given by the people, and according to all things common, was their money in the first place. Somewhere, somehow, along the path, the true teachings of the Messiah were replaced with a gospel, agenda, and blueprint that is absolutely foreign to the ears of heaven. The church has become corrupted to the point that to read about the church in the book of Acts, the original church, compared with the institutions we see today is like looking at two different entities. The so-called apostles of our day are a bunch of pampered charlatans riding around in expensive cars. Some several expensive cars, flying on their own personal multi-million dollar jets, wearing $1,000 suits and $100 socks, living in over-aggrandized superfluous mansions. While the apostles, on the other hand, in the book of Acts would never have even considered over-luxuriating themselves off the blood, sweat, and tears of Yahweh's precious flock. What has happened along the way? Where did we, the sheep, go wrong in supporting such obvious falsehoods that you cannot find the likes of even in our New Testament examples, yet we fill their churches? Did Peter, Paul, Barnabas, John, Matthew, and so on take the hard-earned money from the people of God and spend it on the finest modes of transportation, the finest clothes that money can buy, the largest mansions their lust could consume, and then turn to the congregation of Yeshua and say, "Have faith like me, and you'll get this stuff too"? Do you know how ridiculous this all sounds? Do you know how sickening it is in the eyes of Yeshua, our Lord? If the sheep were spiritually smart, I should be able to rest my case on that last statement alone and need not have to speak another word regarding the matter. But the Holy Spirit has more to say. And even a strong and a stern warning for these false apostles who say they come in the name of Yeshua. While fleecing the flocks of their money, and rather than distributing it to the poor of the congregations that they may have all things common, as the word instructs, they distribute it into their several personal and church bank accounts and throw a few pittance at the poor for good measure. How do these end-time Elmer Gantries get away with such obvious, sinful, greedy behavior? They have turned the house of the Lord into a get-rich-quick scheme that rivals that of the money-robbing infomercials on TV. And my people love to have it so, says Yahweh. These end-time false Christ are able to get away with this because the sheep no longer are seeking the kingdom of God. But whatever it takes to get over in Babylon, including pimping Jesus for a loaf of bread, the modern-day bride of Christ is not getting any cleaner of her spots and blemishes, but has literally broken out in leprosy. She is a corrupt harlot that is nothing more than a money-grubbing gold digger to her betrothed. She won't submit to do what her betrothed requests, but she has constantly got her hand out for more of his riches. When we first came to the Lord, we had a strong love for just knowing him. But over time, we have become hardened in the things of this world and fallen prey to preachers who say they come in the name of the Lord, that have the solution to all of our worldly problems. Then out of our need and our greed, we lose our pliability to continue to grow in the things of the Lord and fall under the spell of the false doctrine of the Babylonian priests, who call themselves the apostles, preachers, and evangelists of the Most High, all the while living in absolute and total violation to his word on what the tithes are to be used for: to pay the expenses of the church and to keep those expenses modest lest they rob the poor, to provide funds for the storehouse. Remember the storehouse, preachers? Or do you just want to skip right over that scriptural command? To truly provide for the poor of the congregation until you have all things common. The tithe is not for the preacher to be able to live in a palace while the congregation lives in tents. The tithe is not for the preacher to buy luxury automobiles while the congregation drives rental racks or has to take the bus. The tithe is not for the preacher to buy $1,000 suits while the congregation has barely enough to buy a decent ensemble at Kmart. The tithe is not for the preacher to schedule expensive holiday cruises disguised to look like missions for the elite of the congregation while the poor of the congregation are left standing at the docks waving bon voyage. Is this what you call having all things common? What utterly sickening Babylonian nonsense and abomination is this that is done in the sight of God and in His name, no less? And you wonder why there is no evidence of the endorsement of God confirming signs and wonders. Why? Because the people are just as much at fault for desiring to lift up their Babylonian priest to celebrity status, and they are willing to pay them with their hard-earned money so that they may boast about how rich their preacher and church is, getting some kind of pagan pleasure out of giving so that they may have their golden calf in the wilderness to worship. Their Babylonian priests and Babylonian temples, yet calling themselves Christians, all the while living in total violation to His word, supporting institutions that are in absolute opposition to the church in the book of Acts. Yes, we have reinvented Christianity, actually reinvented our own religion, which is much more palatable to our carnal senses, yet unrecognized by the one who died for us. Where is the storehouse? Where is the all things common of the book of Acts? Demand the Lord. It's at the preacher's house. While the poor sheep can barely make rent and some suffer eviction and go hungry, while the fat cat Babylonian priests look on in disdain. Have faith, brother. It's just the Lord testing you, they say. But in truth, it is the Lord testing you, preacher. Now listen. Not all pastors are greedy, control freaks, preaching uninspired messages, but according to God's word, many, 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 oh, let's tell the truth, most are. And we are warned harshly in His word to view all pastors with a suspicious eye and are instructed not to surrender to man but to God. They like authority of control and demand respect, yet they do not have any evidence that Yahweh is confirming their word with signs and wonders following according to the word. So they replace the void left by their surmisings with entertainment, smoke and mirrors, says the Lord, to cover for what they do not have, His endorsement. They say that His endorsement is the fact that they have been made rich and that if it wasn't of the Lord, then they would not be so successful. If that's the case, then let's all run to the nearest Catholic church because they are far richer than them all. So, according to these false Christ, gain is godliness. In total contradiction to His word, where He specifically states to run, don't walk away from such who preach this. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 5 through 6, perverse disputings of men of corrupt minds and destitute of the truth, supposing that gain is godliness. From such withdraw thyself. But godliness with contentment is great gain. But we won't withdraw ourselves from such, even though we are commanded to do so in His word. Why? Because we're just as greedy as the preacher and hope that we will get rich by association and both shepherd and sheep become unacceptable and corrupted to the Lord. Then there are those church leaders who have not been called at all, yet have called themselves to the position of leadership. And finally, those who are living their lives in sin and seek to justify their sin with God. And in so doing, they have no anointing. And their words are filled with dogma and puffed up recitations of scriptures, lacking the illumination of the Holy Spirit. They expound rules and regulations wherein there is no true life, but religion. And the seeker of truth is stifled from their search by the fear impressed upon them by the church leaders and members to remain, when the Holy Spirit is saying, it's time to move on. Now, some will say this is subversive to their church or their pastor, which is not true. But Yeshua said, remember your first love. him and not your pastor. Many of us fall into loving our churches or our pastors to the point where they actually replace our love and passion for Yeshua. This is idolatry, plain and simple, regardless that it is for a man of God or a church. It is not Yeshua. Now put down your stones and let's get serious here for a moment. Why did God cause the following prophetic utterance to be published? Why did he say, and whom was he talking to when he said, "An astonishing and horrible thing is committed in the land. The prophets prophesy falsely, and the priests bear rule by their means. And the people, my people, love to have it so. And what will you do in the end thereof?" Jeremiah chapter 5, verse 30 through 31. He's not talking to New Agers, Satan worshipers, or any group of unbelievers. He's saying this to us. My people love to have it so. Why is it we cannot see ourselves guilty of this? Why is it that many who hear this, who are guilty, will utterly ignore it and go about their merry way, thinking that they are being pleasing to God, when they are not? Pride. And as it is written, pride precedes the fall. I'm not asking you to all leave your pastors and churches. No, no. What I'm saying is to not so easily surrender your search for Yahweh to the bottled teachings of man, but to pray about your pastor. Ask Yahweh if you are being taught correctly. Did the preacher tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth in his last sermon? Am I being deceived? Even though you do not believe that you are being deceived, if you knew you were being deceived, you would not be deceived. Do you understand this saying? Yahweh is saying that his people have become far too lazy in their search for him and have relinquished navigational control of their vessels to churches and pastors. A thing that should never, never be done. Your search is not over, and not all pastors these days are as benevolent or anointed by God as they pretend to be. And many, many, many are being deceived in these end times, not by obvious deceivers like cult leaders, but by their own trusted churches and pastors. Now, if you find all of this hard to swallow, God can understand this. But to find it so difficult to swallow that you regurgitate what you are hearing, you have failed in the sight of the Lord and your pursuits are in vain. In closing, I'll show you the very heart and mind of Yahweh on the subject of pastor worship, placing your church or pastor before the Lord himself. Did you know that nearly every single reference to pastors and church leaders in the Bible is negative? Why would God so denigrate this position within his church by making nearly every reference to church leaders in the end times a negative reference? To save his sheep from falling for the many priestcrafts, false teachings, pride, and greed of what he knew was coming in these the last days. He caused it to be written so that his people would stop worshiping their churches and their pastors above him. My word means nothing. Here is what the word says on the subject of the vast majority of end-time pastors. The word pastor is found only 9 times in the scriptures. Let's start with the positive first, which is neither really positive or negative, just a statement that the office does exist within the church. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Evangelists, don't breathe easy. You are considered in the number with pastors, and many evangelists are worse than pastors as they go around the world fathering children that they refuse to raise. And like a stud for hire, they demand payment for fathering children that they will not raise. Now hear and feel the hurt of Yahweh's heart over the condition of the church today. This is quoted in Jeremiah, a book of prophecy that foretold the destruction of Jerusalem, but more importantly for us, foretells the invasion and destruction of America, Babylon, for the same reasons. Jeremiah chapter 10, verse 19 through 21. "Woe to me for my breaking, says Yahweh, My wound is grievous, but I said, truly, this is a malady, and I must bear it. My tabernacle is ravaged, and all my cords are broken. My sons went away from me, and they are not. There's none to stretch out my tabernacle anymore, and to set up my curtains, for the pastors have become stupid and have not sought Yahweh. Therefore they shall not be blessed, and all their flocks shall be scattered. How can we be so unfeeling, and we do not feel our own God's pain and anguish over the condition of his corrupted church? Corrupted by pastors who are not willing to build up his church according to his blueprint, which is given to us plainly and repeatedly in the book of Acts, having all things common, which is to say, if the pastor wants a Rolls Royce, make sure everyone has a Rolls Royce or the financial ability to buy one. If the pastor wants to buy $1,000 suits, make sure that all have the same financial ability to do so. Instead of building Yahweh's house according to his blueprint, the pastors have devised their own, which is designed to be in their favor, and not the sheep. They could not do it if we, the sheep, would not allow it, by refusing to participate in their corrupted meetings. But Yahweh has said very sadly, my people love to have it so. Will any of us lay these things to heart? Will we continue to disappoint and sadden our Father who loves us? Will we as sheep continue to support falsehoods to our own hurt? Or will we stand for righteousness against the flock fleecing pastors who are literally destroying our Father's vineyard? Jeremiah chapter 12, verse 10 through 11. Many pastors have destroyed my vineyard. They have trodden my portion underfoot. They have made my pleasant portion a desolate wilderness. They have made it desolate, and being desolate, it mourns unto me. The whole land is made desolate because no man lays it to heart. Jeremiah 22, verses 21 through 22. I spoke unto you in your prosperity, but you said, I will not hear. This has been your manner from your youth, that you obey not my voice. The wind shall eat up all of your pastors, and your lovers shall go into captivity. Surely then shall you be ashamed and confounded by all your wickedness. We are stubborn, full of pride, and will not even heed the voice of our God over our churches and pastors. It's because of this that tribulation will come, and many will go into captivity. The bride of Christ is an adulterous woman taking on lovers other than her betrothed. She loves her churches and her pastors more than she loves her own husband, Yeshua. Thus she must be purged through tribulation. No, there will be no rapture, thou adulterous whore. Instead, there will be tribulation for your sin of adultery. Pastors, calm down, put down your stones, and instead repent. For you have done great evil in the sight of the Lord, and you know it, by not building up his church as he has instructed. You have profited greatly, but your profit is but filthy lucre in the sight of the Most High, and it shall burn. All that you have accomplished, all that you have acquired, shall be burned in the soon coming days. For you have turned your back on the Most High, and have scattered his flock by your hypocrisy, your entertainment, your lying divinations, and by your greed. Rather than take up stones against a mere messenger, stone me, saith the Lord, Yahweh, stone me. As it is me you have offended, it is not my messenger. Therefore it is I, the offended, who speak these words to you, and these words are backed by my word in Scripture. Therefore you know that they are true, and that they have come from me and not my messenger. Repent, pastors, for the time is short, and my people need to hear the truth. If you will not heed the Master's voice, which you truly know has come not from me, but from him, the following is his closing message to you in Jeremiah chapter 23, verse 1 through 4. Woe be unto the pastors that destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, saith Yahweh. Therefore thus saith the Lord God of Israel against the pastors that feed my people. You have scattered my flock and driven them away, and have not visited them. Behold, I will visit upon you the evil of your doing, saith the Lord. And I will gather the remnant of my flock out of all countries whither I have driven them, and will bring them again to their folds. And they shall be fruitful and increase, and I will set up shepherds over them which shall feed them. And they shall fear no more, nor be dismayed, neither shall they be lacking, saith the Lord.